You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Everyone, welcome to Bio 190. Hopefully everybody knows my name is Kira by now, but I know we do get some people that watch just for fun, so welcome if you are one of those folks. Today we have Stacy with us, and we'll be chatting with her in a few moments. But as we normally do at the beginning of each class, we have some housekeeping stuff to go over as far as what's coming up, what's due, and then of course our live feeds from the aquarium. Now, today's live feed is a little bit different. We don't actually have somebody there today. We're actually going live from our website. So if you are at home and ever want to watch the aquarium's exhibits, you can do that. So if we can pull that up, we're going to be showing you our shark exhibit, so our shark lagoon. You can access this again from our website. But this is a camera underneath the exhibit here. So we see a variety of sharks. Looks like maybe some food there. I don't know what that was. But we have a variety of sharks in here. One of my favorites is the sawfish, which is actually more like a ray that's to our left that maybe might come through the screen here. We have the big ray on the right, which is a reticulated whiptail ray, and some mangrove rays. Huge rays. The mangrove rays are up to about 125 pounds. There's the sawfish. Beautiful example of the sawfish, and we might get a chance to talk about them a little bit later. They are critically endangered because people think it's fun to kill them and put that saw up on their wall. We have blacktip reef sharks. We saw the three just pass there. My guess is this is our sand tiger shark that's stealing the show. So the sand tiger shark has a bunch of teeth we're going to talk about that are sharp and pointy. With any luck, we'll get a good view of that. Sometimes the shark will come by and they look like they're smiling with all their pearly white teeth. Yep, that was the sand tiger on the right there that just swam by. And then let's see, what else do we have here? Stacy, do you see anything else in here?
I know there's a white tip reef shark in there that I don't see.
Yeah, I don't see the white tip either.
The zebra shark at the bottom hanging out.
Yeah, that might be the zebra shark or a nurse shark. I can't tell which because
there's the sandbar.
The sandbar went by on the bottom right. Yeah, they're related to bull sharks. We're going to be talking about them a little bit today. But yeah, in the middle, there's a shark kind of hanging out on the bottom that looks kind of like a rock, like literally in the middle, slightly to the left. And the zebra shark and the nurse shark are two examples of sharks that we have in the exhibit that will stop and just hang out on the bottom of the exhibit. So we'll be talking a little bit about the whys to that later. But again, if you like this stuff, if you're at home and you want to watch it, you can go to the aquarium's website, which is aquariumofpacific.org. It's under exhibits. We have the live feeds. We have Shark Lagoon, Tropical Pacific, Blue Cavern, the sex change exhibit we saw last week, penguin. So lots of really cool exhibits that you can just hang out and watch at home. So, all right, so that is our live feed for today. Again, feel free to go visit that because it's super cool. And then real quick, before we introduce Stacy and get into today's topics, just a few reminders. The field trip paper closed on Friday, so if you have not turned that in, it will be considered late unless you have arranged to turn it in a different time with me. I know there are some folks that have a different due date. You guys are still fine. If you have not arranged a due date with me, it will be considered late. We do have our next paper coming up, which is the research proposal. That's a big paper. I've talked about it numerous times. Make sure you are working on that. Again, that'll be due by the last class. The date and time for that submission is on Blackboard. If you have any questions, because this is a little bit of a challenging paper, please, I encourage you to get in touch with me. Either email me or set up a Skype session with me, and I'll help you in any questions you might have with that assignment. Other than that, we have our normal discussion boards and quizzes every single week. And then our final exam will be opening up after the last day of class. So we are on the downward stretch for the class. That will be in the beginning of December. You'll also have a quiz just like with the midterm. If you have not taken the midterm yet, I have gotten some emails about that. You are out of time to take the midterm. So if you had to miss it, you should have contacted me and set something up. If you have any questions about that, please get in touch with me. Otherwise, that is done. So, all right, hopefully everyone is doing good. With that, we will go ahead and talk to Stacy. Welcome, Stacy. How's it going?
Thank you. Things are well.
We were talking about her last name, Asale. and there's lots of different ways where it can be pronounced. So we were having fun with that. So hopefully that's not too bad, right?
Well, I know how to say it, so that's important.
Yeah, that's the important part. So Stacy joins us. She, again, is just like every week our expert. She actually has done research on sharks, so we're very lucky to have her. But Stacy, why don't you tell us a little bit about where you're from and how you got here and all that fun stuff?
Sure. Well, hi guys. I'm Stacy. I'm from New York. I actually did my undergraduate work at Stony Brook on Long Island, and there I had I received my bachelor's in science in marine vertebrate biology with a minor in environmental studies. And then from there I moved to Miami and I did my graduate work at the University of Miami in Florida at the Rosenstiel School of Marine and Atmospheric Science. But that's a mouthful, so you don't ever have to say that or remember it. And it was there that I did most of my shark research, and I got all of my hands-on experience working on boats and actually going out and tagging sharks. So really, really cool.
That is awesome. I have, when I was doing my internship in college, I tagged sharks. I think, was it you that we were saying we were on some of the same boats?
I don't think so.
I saw someone that had some of the same boats that I tagged sharks.
In Florida?
It wasn't in Florida. No, it was up north a little bit. We were in, let's see, we tagged out, I think, North Carolina.
No, it
wasn't you then. But yeah, it's pretty cool. Like, I've only had some little bit of experience doing it, but it was for a conservation internship, so pretty cool stuff. All right, so speaking of sharks, that is our topic for today. Again, remember, if you have any questions, you can email your questions in or call. We have lots of ways for you to interact with us in class today. Number is 800-339-1193, or of course, as usual, email in your answers and we will address those or comments or whatever it is that you want to tell us about. So, all right, we are going to be talking about sharks. Last week, we talked about fish. And sharks, we mentioned last week, are a type of fish, but they're a little bit special, right?
Exactly. So they're different from the fish that maybe you typically think about. Those are considered bony fish, which I'm sure you got into.
We dissected a mackerel last week. It was awesome. Amazing.
Well, so you guys know all about fish. Well, sharks are a little bit different in that they are a cartilaginous fish. So that means that their bodies, they don't have any bones like we have or like the teleosts have. And they have a skeleton made up of cartilage. So if you wiggle your nose and you could wiggle your ears, that's your cartilage. And so that's their entire skeleton is made of cartilage.
And I remember being in college. Well, no, maybe I was in high school. I don't remember. I was like either a senior in high school or a freshman in college. And it dawned on me that when we talk about vertebrates, means backbone. So since a shark doesn't have a backbone,
right,
is it still considered a vertebrate?
Absolutely. So they do have that spinal cord, which is also a big qualification of being a vertebrate.
Yeah, I've always thought that's kind of interesting. I'm like, wait a minute. And I'm like, oh, that's because a vertebrate definition isn't necessarily the backbone,
right,
but rather a spinal cord. And that they do have, just like being a fish, which is one of the characteristics of having to be a fish. Now, with the sharks, we're also going to be talking about rays, and rays are essentially a flat shark.
Exactly. So it's really funny because at the aquarium, we have our sharks and rays, and we always talk about them together, and most people don't know that they're really close cousins. In fact, rays are technically considered sharks, and that, again, is because they have that cartilaginous skeleton. They don't have the bones, like I had mentioned, that we have.
And one of the main differences here has to do with their pectoral fins, which is why when we saw the saw shark, I said, oh, he's actually more considered a ray than a shark. Can we pull back up the image of the bull shark real quick? I just want to go over the differences here. That when we look at a shark, we can pull this guy full screen here. We've got the pectoral fins, which we are pretty familiar with the fins from last week's dissection. The fins are not attached to the head here, right? We'd say the body there?
Right.
Right. So that's like one of the definitions of being a shark. It has to do with where the pectoral fins are attached. Now, if we go back to that picture of the ray, This would essentially be their pectoral fins, but it is literally attached right there to the head, which is another characteristic of what makes a ray a ray. So if you happen to go back and watch sometime our live feed, you'll notice that the sawfish's pectoral fins are directly attached to the head. So that makes it a ray, not necessarily a shark. So
yeah,
so that's kind of interesting.
Yeah, so like if you were to act out a shark, this would be you being a shark. If you were to act out a ray, this would just be you being a ray.
That's so cute. That's how it's done, if you want to remember. All right, and I know we were going to do an extra credit question about skeletons and cartilage, but we're not going to. We actually changed that a little bit. Can you just tell us a little bit, why do sharks have, like, what's the advantage of having cartilage over bone?
So cartilage is much lighter and much more flexible than bones. And so these animals, maybe you don't think of sharks being flexible, but blue sharks are actually extremely flexible animals. And so, you know, at the aquarium, we always tell people, don't grab the sharks. And they think, well, I'm just grabbing the tail. But they're super, super flexible. They'll bend around and they could really bite you.
So that's
sure.
Kind of awesome.
And so, yeah. And so a lot of sharks, there's that myth that many sharks need to keep swimming to breathe. And in theory, cartilage, you know, definitely keeps them lighter, even though that's not true. Not all sharks do need to swim to breathe. So
yeah, we'll be talking about that in just a second. Let's jump into the general body form and talk about some of those fins a little bit. If we can pull up either the bull shark or the mako shark. I know we talked about, like I said, the fins of the fish last week, but I want to compare that to the fins of a shark. So if we can pull this guy here full screen, there we go. Let's talk. They have a lot of fins.
Definitely. They have several pairs of fins. Here on our mako shark, the most obvious fin that you guys probably know about, that's going to be their dorsal fin. And so that's your classic jaws fin that everyone associates with sharks. And most marine mammals, they have a dorsal fin also. So it's not just a quality of sharks. And that's just because the backside of the animal is called the dorsal side. So marine biologists are super clever and called the fin on the dorsal side the dorsal fin.
And do they normally, or are there sharks that have double dorsal fins as well?
Mm-hmm. So some sharks, like you mentioned,
it would be like there.
They'll have two dorsal fins. And that's a nice way, a nice characteristic that you can use to identify different species of sharks. So like lemon sharks have two dorsal fins that are almost the same size. And that's one way that we would identify lemon sharks when we were pulling them up on the boat.
Well, that's pretty cool. Okay, what other fins do we see here?
And then the second most obvious fin is probably going to be their pectoral fin. So if you think about where your pec muscles are, that's basically where their pectoral fins are. Makes a lot of sense. Again, really clever marine biologists. We also have their pelvic fins. So think about where your bone is. Yeah, where your hips are. And then we have our anal fin in
that
the back. And then the other fin that you guys are probably really familiar with, that's going to be their caudal fin. So, or you guys probably know it as their tail fin, but definitely their caudal. And that has two lobes on it. It's going to have the upper lobe and the lower lobe.
So like this part here and then like this part here,
exactly.
Right?
Okay. And in most sharks, it's relatively balanced. But there are those slower swimming sharks that do have a much larger upper caudal lobe than they do their lower lobe. So,
like the zebra shark, right? Or like
exactly.
A black tip.
So,
that's a good example. Can we go back to the live feed at the aquarium real quick? Because we actually see some sharks that we can maybe point that stuff out to. So there we go. The black tip. Like, tell me again what you were saying about those lobes on the caudal fin there.
So it's not exactly symmetrical, but if you see the black tip reef sharks that are swimming by right there, with the black tips on them, very clever marine biologist, they are slightly more balanced than if you look right in the middle of the tank. You could see, I'm almost positive that's our zebra shark. I'm 90% positive. And you could see maybe that first bump is going to be her first dorsal fin, and then the second one's going to be her second dorsal. And then just underneath, it's really, really long. It's kind of laying on the bottom there. That's going to be the upper, or basically her entire caudal fin. Our zebra sharks don't have a lower lobe.
That looks like all the way in the back swimming. Is that our nurse shark?
It does, the one that just passed on the...
Like, it's all the way in the back in the lighted area between the shadows, because you can see there that tail's really tall up on top, but
and
short on the
bottom.
That's
going to be our sand tiger shark.
Oh, really? Because I didn't really ever notice this fin. But okay, never mind. Well, then, fine. I was hoping the sawfish would come by again so we could see how those pectoral fins were connected to the head, but our sawfish is being kind of shy. She doesn't want to show us.
And uncooperative today.
No fun. So, all right. But yeah, so that gives us a good idea about how they can totally look a little bit different. Now, one of the other big differences, as you mentioned, is the swimming and breathing, right? Like, not all sharks have to swim in order to breathe, but there are some conditions to that.
Exactly. So there is one physical characteristic or one sort of like organ that you could think of. It's called a spiracle. And that is that every single stingray or ray has what's called spiracles, and not every shark does. But the ones that do have them tend to be bottom-dwelling sharks. So, yeah, you could see in this picture just behind us that little hole just behind their eye. That is going to be its spiracle. And this is just, you could think of this as another, an extra gill or an extra gill slit. And so it actually helps them pump water. It helps them breathe, just like gills would.
So if they were to be stopping at the bottom, usually like other sharks, like great white sharks, the black tip reef sharks, they don't have those spiracles, right?
Right.
So how do they breathe?
So I always think this is really funny, you know, working at the aquarium. It's through a function called ram ventilation. And the way I describe it is just imagine if you were running around with your mouth open all the time and you just had to ram air into your mouth. That's what they're doing, but with water. So they have to swim to breathe, and they're ramming water into their mouth and over their gill slits.
So let's pull back up. This is the ray who also has the spiracle real quick. I'm just going to circle that there. You can see the big old spiracle on the rays there, which makes sense because they spend a lot of time sitting on the bottom and their gills are on the bottom. So if they're sitting on the bottom and there's lots of sand there, they're not going to be able to be sucking up water and pulling out the oxygen out of the water. So they've got the spiracles there. Can we pull the picture real quick back up of the mako shark? Because this is a good example, just pointing out that some animals don't have these spiracles. If we can go full screen there. So you'll notice there's nothing here. It's just flat old shark, no openings. And therefore, this is an example of a shark that would have to continue to breathe. There's no getting around having to literally ram water
right
over their gills, right?
And now these mako sharks, they're technically pelagic sharks, or they're open water sharks. So if they were to go settle on the bottom to stop breathing, they would have to go very, very deep. And, you know, not that they can't do that, but it'd be very inconvenient to hang out on the bottom to just take a rest.
And while we have this picture up, something else I want to point out as far as the difference between sharks and other bony fish. Last week, we really dissected the operculum and the gills, and this is different. There's no operculum here on the sharks, right?
Right. So they don't have that bony plate that teleosts do or those bony fish do. They just have these gill slits, and so you could just think of them as like little cuts in the sides of their heads, essentially, and so they're pushing water into their mouth, and that water is coming out over their gills, and then they have special little organs that could actually extract the oxygen from the water that's being rushed over those gill slits.
Can we pull this full screen really quick just to look at the gills now, back and forth? So how many gill slits right here do sharks typically have?
On average, sharks will have 5 gill slits.
So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There. Those last two are kind of mixed together, but you can see it really right here and right there. So, but there are always exceptions, right? So the rule of thumb is that sharks have 5 gills, or gill slits, 5 on each side, and rays are the same way. They're going to have 5 gill slits on each side, but there are always exceptions to the rule. In the case of the 7-gilled shark and the 6-gilled shark, we can guess that they have 7 gills and 6 gills,
respectively.
So we'll be talking about them. We'll be showing a picture a little bit later. But I always think that's kind of fun, right? Do you know if is the 7-gilled shark the only shark that has 7 gills?
I don't think so.
There's more than just the one kind, right?
I believe
so. So at least if you were to find a shark and you counted the gills and it had 6 or 7, you at least have it majorly narrowed down.
Yeah, you could definitely narrow it down.
So that makes it a little bit easier. But we wouldn't know exactly what it is. I mean, if that were the only species that had 7-gilled, we'd for sure be experts and know that was
exactly
a 7-gilled shark. So just keep that in mind. All right. So we talked about the ram ventilation. We've talked a little bit about the lobes there of the shark. I'm just going down my list here. We talked about pectoral fins. All of these fins play a role, though, right? I mean, every fin kind of has a function. We talked about the caudal fin being the one that propels the shark through the water. What are those other fins do?
So we could start with the dorsal fin. So most sharks have, that's going to be, right, our jaws.
We can go back to the mako shark if we can, or even the bull shark. Either one of those will work so we can kind of point these things out again. So you said the dorsal fin here. What does this guy do?
So that's actually going to help our shark move straight, essentially. And so they're shaped almost like a football. And you could think about when you throw a football.
We learned about fusiform last week.
Oh, very nice.
So this is a fusiform.
So you have your fusiform-shaped shark right here. Not all sharks are shaped this way, but definitely our mako. And think about if you were throwing a football, that it would, you want it to spin. You want it to spiral in the air. So essentially, if you cut off all these fins, our mako would just be spiraling through the water. And they definitely don't want that. So most of these fins help them with balance.
And what about these pectoral fins here?
So one thing that I always like to point out is our sharks, obviously they existed before airplanes, so airplanes were designed after sharks and not the other way around. And it's really good in helping them almost like take flight in the water. So they're moving forward and they're really good at maneuvering through the ocean.
And it might help them steer, right? Like if they were going to be turning, that would help them kind of keep their balance as they turn right, turn left. Same thing with the anal and pelvic fins, right? Very similar, and just helping to keep the shark stable. So like just like you said, cut the dorsal fin off, and you're going to have a shark that's kind of teetering back and forth, right? Like that dorsal fin kind of helps keep him upright, especially if they're fast moving.
Yeah.
So like in the case of the whales, because I always relate everything to whales. Right, we talk about the orca who's got the huge dorsal fin, very robust, very fusiform, a very fast-moving whale, big dorsal fin. Same thing with all the sharks. Typically, dorsal fins, especially if they're fast-moving, but like I think of the zebra shark who is not a fast-swimming shark but doesn't have a dorsal fin, right?
Right. Well, they have a very small dorsal fin. Very. You barely saw it when it was hanging out on the floor on our live feed. So.
Yeah.
Doesn't really need it. But basically, like you know, like I said, any function that you could think of the wings of an airplane playing, that's kind of what a shark's fins are doing for them also.
Makes perfect sense. There's one other kind of big thing here that I think separates sharks from other fish, and that has to do with like their scales. We talked about scales last week. We explored them. But the scales of a shark are very different.
Yeah, and you don't really realize how different they are until you touch them. And
yeah.
So at the aquarium, I always encourage people to touch our sharks when they get the opportunity. But sharks don't have the scales that you guys learned about with our bony fish. They have something called dermal denticles. And if you actually break down that word, dermal kind of sounds like dermatologist or a skin doctor, and denticles kind of sound like dentist for teeth. And their skin is actually skin teeth is what that translates into. And so they have really smooth skin if you're touching them from nose to tail, and really rough skin if you're touching them from tail to nose. And so when we would be working with our sharks and we pulled them up on the boat, some of our interns would get, we call it shark burn, and they would actually be, you know, loss of skin, layers of skin would be off of their hands and arms and stuff, because it physically is teeth, like that's what it is.
And they used to use shark skin as sandpaper. So imagine taking sandpaper, just a big hard brush against the sandpaper, and you can imagine what it would feel like to have, you know, whatever shark you touched. And some sharks' dermal denticles are like sharper, more pointier than others, right? I mean,
so those ones that need to swim faster. So sharks are really good at what they do. They've been around for millions of years. They have had to evolve to be awesome, awesome animals. And they've done that in many ways. We've already talked about their tail. You know, eventually we're going to be talking about their teeth. But their skin is one way to do that. So it makes them extremely hydrodynamic. They move very efficiently through the water. And many Olympic swimmers are modeling their wetsuits after shark skins because they will actually move more efficiently through the water. So.
Which is pretty crazy. Can we go back real quick? I want to go back to that picture you had up of the dermal denticle. Can we get that full screen? This is a really cool, like, I don't know if this was electron microscope or what, but like you can really see the one of the dermal denticles here, which I'm always just so fascinated with because it has dentine, right? Just like just like a tooth. It has a root. So literally, I mean, no joke, it's teeth all over the body. That's awesome.
And it's also a form of protection for them. So, you know, even though they're apex predators, there are other animals that want to eat them, like your favorite orca whale that you had mentioned. But also, just daily activities are going to get a little bit intense. So their mating procedure is even aggressive. So females will have thicker skin than some males.
Interesting. Yeah, we see our sharks sometimes when we put the males and females together. They like to get it on a little bit. And like you said, it can be a little interesting because the males will like grab onto the females. I mean, they'll bite the pectoral fins and hold on for dear life. But yeah, it's kind of interesting. But I didn't realize that the females, I mean, it makes perfect sense, but never thought about it. So kind of cool. All right, and then a stingray's stinger is a modified dermal denticle. So it's kind of like a long fingernail or tooth, I guess, right?
Exactly. So we could see it really nicely in this picture here. Again, just a modified dermal denticle or modified scale that these guys have. And so not all rays are stingrays, so not every single ray is going to have that barb on it.
Can we pull this full screen? Let's see if we can take a look at the barb here. So this is the barb right here. You can just see it kind of lifted up on the tail there. Explain to me how people get stung by stingrays, why we've got this full screen.
So, well, this is a concept that's relatively new to me, not being from the West Coast. But you guys have your stingray shuffle that you do, yes? And yes. You walk through the sand and you shuffle your feet through.
So the idea is to never lift your foot up and step, right?
Exactly.
Can we pull this picture full screen real quick? We're gonna do a little visual here, right? So if you're a person and you've got your foot here, right? And you step down on a ray that's like hidden under the sand, tell me what happens next.
So, well, if you're stepping on a ray, most likely what he'll do is swim forward and that barb will puncture your skin and then it will enter your skin.
Yeah, or they'll like flip their tail up like this, right? So they immediately flip their tail up. So imagine this barb here literally goes whoop right into your foot. And so when people get stung, usually after they step on it, that ray thinks they're about to get eaten or they don't know what's going on, but they're going to use all the things they can, which of course is their barb, to protect themselves because I don't know, stingrays overall are pretty docile. I mean,
they have
a bad reputation, but they're not out trying to sting people, right?
No, it's not going to be energetically cost effective to them. They're going to use a lot more energy putting this barb into you than they would want to. So it's kind of like a last resort. Kind of like when a bee stings you. No, they don't want to sting you. They don't want to die. And not that they're dying, but it doesn't do anything for them to have to grow this barb back.
Right, yeah. It's all about, I love to point that out, it's all about the conservation of energy because that ray needs to be spending its energy looking for food, reproducing, hiding from predators.
Exactly.
If it has to use any extra energy on reproducing that barb, that's a cost. That's a big cost to the ray that could be using it, you know, storing extra energy or whatever it might be. So they don't literally want to use it unless they feel like they have to. You know, when people get stung, they get these bad reputations and it's not necessary. If you just shuffle your feet.
I know. I'll have to practice.
So the idea is to shuffle your feet at the beach because what happens is the rays will feel the vibrations in the sand, which we'll talk about, and they'll usually swim away. They'd much rather swim away than have to use that barb. So if you're not picking up your feet, you're not going to risk stepping on them. So you just shuffle your feet as you're walking, you scoot forward, and you're safe, hopefully, right? I mean, that's in theory. All right, Wes, do sharks, like the great white, ever get tired from constantly swimming? What do you think?
I'm sure they don't, like, translate tired the same way we translate tired. We're like, oh, I didn't get enough sleep last night. I'm so tired, you know. I think that's just kind of, you do what you need to survive, like Kira had mentioned. And so that's not even really an option for them.
And I think it's probably built in. I mean, like what we think of getting sleep of 8 hours is our norm, where maybe some animals' norm is way less sleep, but that's just what they function on. And then they can also slow down quite a bit.
Of course,
right?
Yeah.
So if they're resting, they don't have to be maintaining this like kind of constant cruising speed. Our sand tiger, who is a ram ventilator, moves so slow sometimes you think it's not moving.
Yeah.
But it'll just be like a little thrust.
Exactly.
And just literally like just kind of coasting along. So they're not always swimming like we would imagine. They will slow down quite a bit.
And that's also just kind of another way of asking, like, do sharks ever get tired of breathing? You know, like, do we ever get tired of breathing? No, you have to do it.
Hearts have to beat all the
time.
And yeah, it's just part of how the body is built. And those particular sharks, they seem to do pretty well. Otherwise, they wouldn't be here.
Exactly.
All right. So speaking of, I talked about the stingray shuffle and how they're going to feel us coming. Let's talk about some shark senses, because sharks are a little bit special. We have 5 senses, but they have like 6, and I don't know how people consider the lateral line a 7th or not.
Right.
But for sure, they have at least 1 more sense than us. Let's talk about some of those.
For sure. So you said they're a little bit special, but I think they're a lot of bit special.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
It's okay.
So we'll talk about the first one. So let's work down the order of what they're best at to what they're least best at,
sure.
or what, you know, which one's the least strong. So we'll start with hearing. Tell me about that.
So believe it or not, sharks do have ears. Obviously, they don't have ears like us. They have an internal ear. So the structure is pretty similar to our structure, but not exactly the same. And they're really good at hearing. They could hear up to a mile away. And so that's obviously not the sense that you guys probably know about sharks being famous for, but they're really good at hearing.
Yeah, everyone knows them as smelling, but that's like that's what, 3rd on the list, right?
Yeah, it's not even, not top one, not number one, that's for sure.
Yeah, definitely not number one. number 2, right, number 2. So I imagine like if I'm a shark, and I'm in the ocean and I'm hunting, the first thing I'm gonna do is, let's say I'm a great white, I'm looking for a seal. The first thing I'm gonna do is hear a seal struggling.
Exactly.
And then once I kind of get the idea of where the sound is coming from, I'll start heading in that direction. And then next is smelling, right?
Exactly. So once they figure out which direction to move it towards and they kind of narrow down or are homing in on this animal, they'll start to, their smell or their olfaction will kick into gear, and that will start to help them, you know, pinpoint where that prey is, even, you know, even more specifically. So,
and they can smell up to like 1,000 feet away?
I believe 1,000 feet.
That's
really far. That's really far.
So when we talk about sharks having a great sense of smell, smelling blood, it is true, but they just are better at hearing. So
exactly.
Just want to point that out.
So I know there's that. There's that statistic that they could smell 1 drop of blood per, what is it?
1 million drops of water. Yeah.
And we like to use blood because that's scary, but it's really, they could smell another fluid per million drops of water. So we like blood because we associate sharks as being killers.
But they're not.
Which they're not.
I just want to pet this great white shark that's here behind me.
Actually,
while we have this, can we pull this full screen real quick? Because I think can't we see the nose here?
Yeah.
So that's right here, right?
Exactly.
So you can see it there, and there would essentially be another little hole there. So they actually have openings as a nose, right?
So 2 nares, and those are only used for picking up or detecting different fluids in the water. So they're not really smelling like an odor like we smell in air. They're picking up a different concentration of something that's in the water through these nares. So definitely not used for breathing the way we use our nostrils. There's no connection to their gills at all. So
interesting.
Very interesting.
But logical. So those are both senses that we have. We hear, we smell. But the next one is a little bit special. So this is lateral line. And I guess, is this a form of hearing?
You could say it's a form of hearing. It's detection.
So yeah, because I always get confused with lateral line. Is it hearing or is it feeling vibration?
It's more like feeling.
Vibration.
You're feeling something. So this lateral line that exists, it's really, really cool. It's really awesome. You know, like I mentioned, sharks, they've been around for millions of years, so they have to be really good at what they do. And this lateral line definitely helps them be efficient hunters. So there is a bunch of pores that run down the sides of their bodies, and I know you probably talked about it.
Yeah, we talked about it last week. We can see that lateral line. So here we can see the lateral line.
Yeah.
Like the dots, right? Like these things here.
Yeah, all those little.
My fingers.
Like pores.
Yeah.
So, and those help detect motion in the water and any sort of water movement, and that could help them. So after they've heard you, after they've smelled, not you, but their prey, and then this lateral line is going to kind of kick into gear once they're within like 300 feet of their prey. So
we talked about that with the schooling fish. So like the one schooling fish, as it moves through the water, it's producing these waves in the water, like vibrations, energy, and then all the other fish behind it, if that fish were to turn, it changes the vibration of the water. All the fish can instantly pick that up. That's from the lateral line. And then the schooling fish all know to make a right-hand turn or a left-hand turn. And it almost looks instantaneous.
Yeah.
So sharks also, because they're fish, have that lateral line and can pick that up, feel the vibrations in the water.
for sure.
Okay, so we don't have that one.
No, we don't.
No, we don't have that one.
That would be all really right. cool if we had that.
But again, that's also, it's not necessarily a, it's a different way of detecting, but it's still like a feeling or a hearing. So it's not necessarily a different sense. We just don't have the ability to sense that way.
Right.
I mean, I guess that's how I would picture it. And then the next is vision. So people are like, oh, sharks have horrible vision, but it's actually not too horrible, right?
No, sharks, some sharks actually have really good vision. That is a myth that they say shark, well, they're not seeing you, but they, in fact, they are seeing you. They can see up to 70 feet away in like really clear water, and that's very impressive. You know, we could see obviously 70 feet away without any obstructions in our view, but that's really,
I mean,
really good.
It would be like water dependent too. Like if it's murky water, yeah. they can't see through the murkiness. It'd still have to be clear water.
Right.
So that's not necessarily the shark not being able to see. That's just conditions aren't great.
Right. So like you can think about that same idea here in California when it's really foggy in the morning. Like we could see very far, but you're not going to see very far if it's really hazy in the morning.
Right. So. Right. Okay. So we have, looks like a comment here. Wes, we got yours, and then I think Anon. I was stung by a stingray while surfing once. It hurt really bad, it hurt really badly until I placed the wound under hot water, which removes the proteins in the toxins. So yeah, that is basically the toxins and like the venom, same thing with like a sea jelly. It's a protein, so if you are able to break the protein up, that's going to help with the pain. Right, absolutely. Dallas. What level of the sea do sharks live in? And that is a great question because we haven't really addressed that yet because we've been
really
talking kind of broadly. But we have talked about a lot of habitats so far. We first started the class with habitats. Now we're kind of more specifically into phylums and animals. But we've talked about rocky shores. We've talked about kelp forests, deep sea, pelagic, and polar seas.
Okay.
Can we find sharks in all of those?
So, yes. Then that is what's so cool. And again, that goes back to them being really good at what their, you know, their mission, which is to survive. And so they've adapted ways to live in every sort of habitat in all levels of the sea, from, you know, the surface of the sea all the way down to the bottom. You have these really deep, like, sleeper sharks. They're really slow swimming, awesome looking sharks, and they're just all over. They're really, really cool.
And there are sharks that live in polars too, right? It's like we were talking about the Greenland
shark. Like
the
Greenland shark, for sure.
Greenland shark is pretty awesome. We almost made the extra credit question about the Greenland shark today, but you'll see what we did in a little bit. But anyway, yeah, so you can find sharks pretty much everywhere. Now, that doesn't mean that you can pull a shark from the deep sea and put it in the pelagic sea.
Right.
Like, they're going to be adapted to their very specific habitat. So
exactly.
Depending on where you go, you're going to find different sharks that are specialized for that habitat.
Exactly. And just to, kind of to add on to that, you know, like, not every shark looks like that mako shark picture mm-hmm. that we've been showing you. So, like you mentioned, in, like, a kelp forest, you're going to have sharks that are adapted to living in a kelp forest. And, like, our leopard shark is going to be much smaller than that mako shark. So not every single shark looks like our pelagic mako shark.
And that brings up the great point too, speaking of diversity with that, most sharks are pretty small, right? I mean, 3 feet and smaller.
Yeah, there's only about 10 sharks that are really, really big. So probably bigger than, I don't know, probably
like 10, 12 feet.
Yeah.
I mean, we'll talk about some of the sizes in a little bit, but for the most part, I mean, most sharks, there's over 350 species.
Yeah.
Most of them are smaller than 3 feet, like 3 to 3.5 feet. So this gives you an idea of when we talk about sharks, very rarely are we talking about large sharks that we
exactly.
might think of as a shark. All right, so going back to our senses here, the next one coming up, so vision was about 70 feet, then we have the electrical sense, and this is like, oh, the new sense that we would no way be able to have. Walk me through this one.
Oh, this is so cool. It's one of the coolest things about sharks, even though they're really awesome all the time. So they have these little jelly-filled sacs underneath their nose. You could actually see them in the picture behind me.
So we're talking about these little dots, right? Like,
and those have a special name. Those are called the ampullae of Lorenzini, or the ampullae of Lorenzini. And they are jelly-filled sacs that are able to detect electric pulses in the water. So that they can find, once they've honed in on their prey, they could tell like the relative area of where they are. If that prey is hidden, they can sense it in the ampullae of Lorenzini, which is so, so cool. So they can detect very minute electrical pulses, and that's from about 4 inches away. So they have to be almost on top of their prey to find it. But there's some really cool videos of hammerheads that use this, because their fish or their prey will hide underneath the sand, and these hammerheads will kind of like scan.
Well, it's kind of why we see their
sand.
Heads kind of moving back and forth, right? Like they're scanning with that ampullae.
Yeah, think about if we had like a metal detector on the beach and you're scanning, right? And so that's what they're doing. They're scanning the sand. It's so cool.
We actually have a video that you found.
I did.
That's pretty cool. So we'll show you this video. It's going to be the electrical sense video. And then you can maybe walk us through. I don't remember if there's sound for this one or not, but you can walk us through what we're seeing. But we're essentially going to see sharks going over a study area. And real quick, actually, before we get to that video, why is it important? What about the electricity or the electrical impulses? Who cares if it's electrical impulses, right? Like, let's discuss why that's important. What are they detecting if they're detecting electrical sense?
So in our bodies, we have these ions. And ions are just things that have a charge to them. And so anytime you have an electron or something that has this negative and then as a result also a positive charge to it, it's going to create a magnetic field. And so anytime it's moving, it's creating a magnetic field. And so we actually have that. If you think about the way our heart works with the different sodium gates and stuff that we have, it's really, and the potassium gates, it's really, really interesting. And so we have our own, each living thing has its own very minor electric field, which is very cool.
I think about how our heart beats, right? And if you were to go to the doctor or the hospital and they have a heart monitor hooked up to you, it's going beep, beep.
Yeah.
Beep, beep, right? That's detecting, that machine is detecting the impulse every time the heart beats, right?
Right.
So it would be something like that where they have their own little heart monitor detector, whatever, because that would be an example of giving off a little pulse of electricity.
It's a silly way of thinking about it.
I just think of hospitals and beep beeps.
Yeah. So high tech.
Yes. All right. So let's take a look at this video. We'll see this in action. The sharks kind of swimming over sand and they immediately get pulled back to this one area. Yeah. So if we can pull that up, we'll take a look here.
So this is going to be our juvenile sandbar shark. And you could see it kind of biting down at the sand. And when you look down on it, you could see these are what we call dipoles, and they're on right now, which is why they're reacting. And it's really, really interesting that these animals were kind of trained to associate this electric pulse with food. And so every time they turned it on, they would let out the scent of squid or fish. And so then what they did is they stopped releasing that scent and studied how they reacted just when the dipole was turned on. And so that's going to be your scalloped hammerhead that just swam by there.
And so they were like immediately pulled to it.
Yeah, they were basically trained to associate it with food. And then in the absence of food, they still were able to sense it. So it wasn't just the food that was causing that reaction. So really, really cool.
Yeah, I love it. All right, so that electrical sense, 4 inches away, like you said, you didn't see it. They went over it, felt it, and then came right back to it. So it wasn't like they knew where they were going exactly. Like they had to actually cross it, and they're like, whoop, that's it.
Yeah, they were right on top of it, like you saw in that video.
And then the last senses that we do have would be touch and taste. And how close do you have to be to touch something to feel it?
I don't know if I understand that question.
We get that. So you have to touch it, right?
Yeah.
So when we do the boards at the aquarium, this is actually funny. I like to share this story because it's so funny that all the distances that we just went over, like a mile for hearing and 1,000 feet for smelling, right on top of the shark is touch and taste. Uh-huh. And so the kids are supposed to put it in order what they think, and touch and taste, they'll put it at a mile away. Well, how close do you have to be to touch something? Like,
zero.
You have to be zero. You have to be touching it, right? So it's always kind of funny that people don't make the connection. They're like, oh, the sense of touching. Well, you have to be touching it to feel it and touch it.
I know. Like that, you're just asking me the same question.
I know. It makes it funny. So anyway, and then there's touch and taste. So in order to taste something, in this case, they're smelling, like you said, is their smelling attached to their tasting like it is with us?
So they do kind of have a palate that tastes. And it's actually, they have a preference for food, which maybe everyone thinks of kind of sharks as like mindless eating machines and they'll just eat everything, and that's really not the case. They have preferred diets, and so there's many cases of, in the cases of humans being bit by a shark, they're essentially spit out. They're very not on the menu at all. So they do have a preference for food, and, you know, it's not us.
Yeah, so definitely able to taste it. So, and I think that's always important, you know, when we talk about how sharks don't eat people. Like, there are reasons that sharks don't eat people. It's not because, oh, we don't want you to be afraid of sharks and we need to conserve sharks, which we do.
For sure.
But we're not pulling your leg. There's actually a reason to that.
Yeah, and also quickly, touch and taste for sharks kind of go hand in hand. They don't have fingers like us. They can't be like, oh, this is a desk. You know, this is hair. They don't have that ability to do that. So their touch almost is their taste, and their, this sounds like really sugar-coated, but they're touching you with their mouth. They're saying, what are you? You know, and it just kind of goes hand in hand. And once they say, oh, you're not what I'm looking for, that's where that ends.
Nope, never mind. Forget that. So, yeah, that's a very good point. All right, with that, we are halfway through the class, so we are going to take a break, do our normal thing, get a drink, get a snack, do whatever you got to do. We'll be back in about 5 minutes, and then, of course, as we usually do when we return, we will do our mystery item, our extra credit question, and continue on with the rest of the lecture. So we will see you back in about 5 minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We're passing out information for all the parents that come in, so we're letting them know where the workshops are, what time, and what to find and send to them.
General Manager here at LA 36. I'd like to take a moment to thank you for watching our channel and to tell you some important information that will be affecting some Time Warner customers in the city of Los Angeles. Beginning October 8th, if you do not have a cable box, digital adapter, or cable card, you will not be able to see LA 36 and some other channels like this one. You'll need to contact Time Warner to get a free digital adapter. Here's how. You can call 855-286-1736 or go online to twc.com/digital adapter. It's that easy to continue seeing the programming you love, Los Angeles. From the stunning performances at the Ford Theater to the thought-provoking speakers at the Los Angeles World Affairs Council to the revealing political discussions from LMU and all the educational programming from our partners at schools like Cal State Dominguez Hills and USC. So contact Time Warner today for your free digital adapter. You won't want to miss 1 minute of LA 36, your connection to your community. Thank you for your support. We appreciate you watching.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, welcome back. So as usual, we will start with our mystery item for today. So we have this here that we will show you. I'm going to try and bite my tongue and not accidentally let it slip what it is.
A close eye.
So anyway, if we can get a visual maybe up from up top here. There we go. Yeah. We'll take a look here. See if you can figure out what this is. Kind of move it around all different ways here. Lots to see. There's lots of dynamics to this. All right. All right. So if you think you know what this is, go ahead and call in. I'm trying to get it so we can leave it there. There we go. All right. So if you think you know what this is, then call in or email in, and you will get an extra credit point. The first person to get it correct gets it. So, all right. We'll move that out of the way. And now we're going to move on and chat a little bit about, I think, what a lot of people associate with sharks, their teeth.
Okay.
Right? And sharks are pretty awesome because they don't have the bones. They have cartilage in their jaw. So their teeth aren't anchored in like ours, right?
Right, right. And so whereas if we as adults lose our teeth, they're gone forever. You have to go get a nice expensive implant. But our sharks are really, really lucky that they don't have to do that. They actually are constantly replacing their teeth. So if you think of how a chainsaw works, every time that blade is on, you constantly have another blade following it, another little spike. And so sharks' teeth are exactly like that, and they could lose up to 30,000 teeth in their lifetime. I'm sure it could be more than that even, but 30,000 is kind of where we...
Right. kind of estimate there. With that, as far as losing their teeth, what is the... Why would they lose their teeth? Like, how come, do you know why they don't just anchor in? Like, is it just because there's no bone?
Well, not having bone is kind of what causes them to fall out, right? So they don't have our jaw at all by any means. But if you also think about it, sharks are, they need their teeth, again, that's how they're touching things. And so they constantly have to be sharp. And if you are constantly replacing a tooth, you're always going to have a really sharp one coming up. Think about how our teeth have kind of, they're not sharp at all. We use them every single day. We use them all the time. They get relatively dull. And sharks, they can't really, you know, afford to have dull teeth. That's what they rely on to survive. So they always have a sharp tooth.
Perfect. All right, we have some guesses coming in. Philip, a stingray mouth. No, it is not a stingray mouth. We want something even more specific than that, even if it were a stingray mouth. We want to know what kind of ray. Wes, this is my favorite answer. It's a whatchamacallit.
Yeah, that's right.
That's a good guess. No, that one's good. And Caleb, same thing. He said stingray jaws, not stingray jaws, but we're on the right track, kind of, sort of. So, all right, we also have a call. Who is calling today? Is this Abby by chance? Just wondering. Oh, no, Crystal. All right, Crystal, you think you know what it is? Go ahead.
Hi, I think it's a shovel-nosed guitar fish mouth.
Ooh, good guess. Good guess. Shovel-nosed guitar fish mouth. It is not a shovel-nosed guitar fish mouth, but good guess. I'll pull it back over. We'll show it up. Thank you for calling, Crystal. Good luck. Maybe you can try again, and we'll see. So kind of show it this way as well. See here. Kind of fun. All right, and if we can maybe get it zoomed back in, I'm not sure which camera we're going to go to here, but we'll try and show again. I think this one over here. There we go. Okay. All righty. So... kind of interesting looking. I know. I'm good. I'm glad we... normally, I get so upset because they guess on, like, the first or second guess, so we're four in. I'm feeling pretty good today.
I'll have to get the extra credit point. No one else.
No, they will get it. I know it. I know they will. James is getting ready here. Gosh, darn it, James!
Spoke too soon.
I spoke too soon. James got it, the Port Jackson shark.
And he gave you the genus species name.
I know. What is it? Heterodontis Port Jackson, Jacksoni, I think. So, anyway, Portus Jacksoni. Yes, that's it. James, thank you for ruining my role I was on. No, good job, though. So, yes, it is a Port Jackson shark. And I think that you'll all, if we can pull this full screen, probably be shocked to see what the shark looks like. It looks kind of like a normal bottom-trolling shark. I mean, I guess maybe to me because I see lots of bottom-trolling sharks. But this is what it looks like. So this kind of crazy-looking mouth goes to a shark that looks like that. Yeah. And we have a local species that looks like that, right?
We do. Our horn shark looks very, very similar to the shark here. And that horn that's right in front of their dorsal fins that you guys now know where they're located is a really determining factor on their similarities.
Right. Can we pull this full screen real quick? So they're actually related, or they're kind of all together in the horn shark, I guess, family. There's lots of species. You can just barely make out the little horn there and the little horn there. So that's one of the reasons they're called horn sharks. But actually, these like kind of raised parts right here make it look like it's got horns. So that's, I believe, the main reason they're called a horn shark. But we have a local horn shark that we call horn shark that looks very, very similar to this. The colors are a little bit different, but these guys are from Australia versus our local species here. Ours are brown with black spots, which I think we'll have time to look at a little bit later. So good job, James. Let me write your name down. James, for ruining my role. No, I'm just kidding. Totally kidding. Okay, so James, I'll give you an extra credit point. Good job. And that brings up our second extra credit point for the day. I'm going to move this guy out of the way, which is for all the folks that are not watching live. If you are watching live, you can also participate in this as well. But we want to make sure that the people that aren't allowed to watch live or can't make the time right now, that they get an extra credit point opportunity as well. So that brings up our extra credit question today. If we can show that. It's basically, why do sharks have big livers? So that's going to be the question. Again, remember, email in your answer. I need to see a link of some sort so I know where you got your answer to make sure that it's a legitimate source. You might notice I'm giving a little bit of feedback on the sources that are being used for that research proposal because we want good, reputable sources, not some
Wiki Answers.
Wiki Answer or Ask.com. Those are not good, reputable sources. So you might see me give you feedback on those. That's why I do that. And again, why do sharks have a big liver? So if you find that out, email in the answer and you will get an opportunity for another extra credit point. So, all right, moving on. Since we're talking about mouths here, we saw the Port Jackson mouth. Let's dive in and talk about different types of teeth that we see in the varieties of different types of sharks. So let's start with the pointy and sharp fellow here.
Okay. So this is just another example of sharks being really, really good at what they're made to do.
And I don't know, we're probably not going to be zoomed in enough here. I'll probably have to go back to the thing here. But these literally are, like you said, pointy and sharp, right?
For sure.
So what kind of information will this give us? If we look at a shark and we're like, oh, I don't know what kind of shark this is, but I can look at its mouth and see that what?
Right. So the shape of their teeth is a very good indicator of the type of food that they're eating. So just like Kira mentioned, they're really sharp, they're really pointy. And this is really good because these animals, or this probably belongs to a mako shark or a sand tiger shark, they're eating really slippery, slimy, like medium-sized fish and squid. And so if you think about, you're going to use your fork to kind of puncture slimy food that's on your plate. Mm-hmm. And so they essentially just have a mouthful of forks.
Literally.
Literally.
Not literally.
Literally.
Figuratively. So, playing with Stacey a little bit here. Anyway, but yes, they do have super pointy teeth. And one of the other things, sorry, if we can go back to that camera one more time, since we were talking about sharks losing teeth, we can see that a little bit here. You can see there's a row here. This one right here is laying down flat. Once this one here gets pulled out, whether being eating or it just moves forward, then this one will flip up or take the place. And there's actually, if you could get a really good view here, lots of layers of teeth that aren't quite fully developed that
right.
will start to move forward as they become more developed.
Right, so they will never run out of teeth, which is really, really cool.
I wonder if they actually could run out of teeth.
I wonder.
Like if they just get to a certain age and they all of a sudden can't produce teeth anymore, like, I don't know. Who knows,
we'll
right?
We'll have to find the oldest shark and ask them.
Definitely. I love that idea. All right, so they're going to be eating kind of slippery foods, right? Like fish, slimy fish, maybe squid, something that they're going to spear through. But that's different than, let's say, if we were to pull up this shark's mouth, which this would be like a great white or like a bull shark. They have even different special teeth. And we have a close-up actual picture of this. But walk me through what kind of teeth these are.
So these are what we call serrated teeth. And if we could get a really nice zoom on the top teeth, they're almost like little
kind of
knives. And if you think about the way a knife works that has those little bumps on it, it's meant to cut through mostly meat. And these animals, these sharks that have these serrations on their teeth, they're eating large marine mammals typically, or probably larger sharks.
Right. We have a picture. Can we pull up the serrated teeth picture real quick? There we go. Pull this full screen for me. There we go. So these right here is what you're talking about, right?
Yeah. So you could see... Basically, if you were to only look at one half of it at a time, it would just look like a knife. So think about if you took two knives and put them back to back, that is what these serrated teeth look like.
So this is like jaggedy, like
yeah.
this.
Exactly. Yeah. And they're super, super sharp. And so like sharp, and in the case of like our great white shark, if you think about the kind of food that they're eating seals and sea lions and really large marine mammals. So these teeth actually act like a knife, and they'll cut through these animals like their flesh, and they'll be able to take a nice big bite out of them.
And that's like if you imagine, you know, in videos or Shark Week, when you see them eating these big things, they chomp in and they shake their head back and forth. So it's like they're literally working like their teeth through the flesh. So these serrated teeth are really going to help cut things apart. And it's hard to see here, I know, but on the bottom teeth of this jaw, they're pointy like the fork, and then the top teeth here are the serrated like the knife. So they really kind of crunch in, get it, shake, and then out comes their nice marine mammal fillet or whatever it is that they are after.
Yeah, they have very good table manners. They eat with a fork and a knife.
Right in their mouth. So that's like the great white or like the bull shark. And then moving on, this is kind of a different one. This is the zebra shark. So we saw the zebra shark in the exhibit during the live feed. That shark is like 10 feet long.
Yeah.
And it has this itty-bitty mouth.
Right. And so kind of bringing it back to their tail, the shape of their tail, we could tell they're really slow swimmers. And the slower swimmers are probably going to be resting on the bottom. And these teeth are really good for eating animals that will live.
Bring it over here.
That will live on the bottom. And they're going to be eating smaller fish. And even like shrimp, maybe things that have a harder external skeleton, like a crustacean.
And these are like little itty bitty teeth.
Yeah,
so
really
this,
tiny.
If you could feel this right now, what I'm rubbing, and these are replicas, so this isn't exactly the jaw, but it's very, very similar. This feels like the rough side of Velcro.
Yeah, that's
so
a good
that's
way
how
of
I describe
it.
When I say some of these. So they're going to have crushing. They're going to be able to break things apart, but they're also kind of grabbing some slippery things too. So it's like the rough side of Velcro here. But again, just a very small mouth for a large shark. So
exactly.
Just because it's a big shark doesn't mean it has a big mouth.
Right. And also the size of their mouth dictates the size of the food that they're going to be eating. So, you know, this shark right here isn't eating a seal or a sea lion.
No, not by any means. The picture we have behind us is another type of really crushing type jaw. This is something we might see like in stingrays, right?
Right. So in our bat ray, again, that same philosophy of spending a lot of time on the bottom is going to dictate the type of food that you're eating. So these are totally bottom-dwelling sharks, you could say, and they're going to be eating things that live on the bottom, so typically crabs or hard-shelled animals, like
so
clams.
Just real quick, like their mouth would be coming over like a clam like this, and then closing and crunching, right?
Yeah.
So these plates would start closing.
Yeah, just like that.
So you got this hard plate here and the hard plate here that come together and...
Right. If you like, think about it as if you were cracking a walnut or something, or a peanut, and you were to put in a nut cracker, and then you would break it. It's the same exact mechanism that this
Ray is using.
Love it. So yeah, that's a good example there of the rays. And again, their mouths are on the bottom, so we know that they're gonna be looking for things that live in the bottom.
Yeah.
And we have a couple of video, oh no, wait, before I jump the gun here. We talked about gill rakers last week, and we were actually able to show some gill rakers, but we have some video of a basking shark filter feeding. But they're different. They don't use their teeth for eating, right?
They do have teeth. They have these really, really tiny, tiny teeth. But that's not what they're using to eating. They are, like Kira mentioned, they're filter feeders. So they're actually, if you think about what a filter does, it's cleaning the water. And so they'll swim with their mouth open, and all of this water with all these tiny organisms in it will get sucked into their mouth. And then those gill rakers that, you know, kind of just like on a fish are in their gill slits, are going to start collecting all the little organisms in there, and that's what they're going to be eating.
So those are the gill slits right there, right? Like we can almost see like the water's going in this way.
Yeah.
And then
just being flushed over those gill slits.
Cool. Is this his eye there?
Yeah.
Oh,
and what I really love is that this basking shark is one of the largest sharks. Our basking shark and our whale shark, like you mentioned, is the largest fish in the ocean, and they have the tiniest teeth, and you're eating some of the smallest animals. So
we actually have a picture of a whale shark in case you're not familiar with what whale sharks look like. People will actually go swim with whale sharks. These are like gentle giants that are just...
I just added it to my life to-do list today.
I know. This is on so many people's bucket list, probably mine too. But, I mean, whales for me first, and then the whale shark. But, yeah, you can just see they have this, like, kind of long, open mouth here. But same thing. They're going to be filter feeding using those gill rakers. So let's pull up that video of the basking shark feeding on the DVD there. Let's take a look and see what that's like. And then, Tishana, we'll get back to your question in just a second. So, all right, let's see if we can pull that video up of the basking shark on the DVD. There we go. I think this one has sound, so we might...
This huge 8-ton fish feeds on plankton and nothing else. Every hour, it filters 1,000 tons of seawater through its gills. Numbers of these shark appear when the bloom is at its peak and travel along those water currents where the plankton is thickest. Even so, the supply of plankton is so abundant that another group of animals is able to share in the feast, animals that live on the sea floor. The manta must have known this was about to happen, for it arrived at exactly this critical moment, and it's not the only one to do so. Others are here too. Now, all they need to do is to sweep the water into their mouths and sieve out the eggs. Within an hour, the whole event will be over. Any surviving eggs will be so dispersed that they're not worth collecting. Unlikely though it seems, the sandy floor of the open sea is, for the bat ray, a rich feeding ground. There is food hidden within the sand, and the bat ray has a special technique for finding it. It uses jets of water to blow the sand aside and expose small invertebrates. A kelp bass hangs about alongside, waiting for scraps.
Okay, so we got a little bit of a view of different types of feeding. So we saw the basking shark. The manta ray, I think I'm glad that that video is there, is very similar to the basking shark, right? They're filter feeding that whole time, but then we saw a comparison of the other ray on the bottom there that was doing the crunching.
Exactly.
And you could hear,
I don't know if you guys heard that audio, but of it breaking the shell of what it was eating.
Delicious. So. Hungry. So, all right, so those are just some ways that the sharks will feed and the rays will feed. Now, Tishana has a question. Do sharks and dolphins get along or do sharks eat them? And that is a great question. It's actually reversed of what you might think. They don't get along. They don't ever work together. They might feed in the same area. There's lots of fish going on, large schools of fish. We might see sharks feeding in the same area as dolphins, but they're definitely not working together. And it's actually been more documented. I don't know if it's more, but probably more common.
More than you guys would think.
Right. That dolphins actually prey on sharks. Again, remembering that sharks are usually pretty small. And in the case of like the larger sharks, great whites, there is actually a documentary that came out a couple of years ago called The Whale That Ate Jaws. And that's about a pod of orcas that actually used to be off of LA that were specialized in eating sharks, specifically great whites. So,
oh.
Yeah, they won. Sorry, Stacey.
It's okay.
But anyway, yeah, the great whites, what they do is they would grab, or the orcas would grab the great whites and stop. So again, they're ram ventilators, so they're going to continue to try and breathe. They have to continue to swim, but since they can't swim,
right. They
essentially suffocate, and then the sharks feast on them. And literally, within the last couple of days, there have been orcas spotted off of Hawaii eating a thresher shark.
Very interesting.
Super cool. So you lose, and I win.
But to touch back on that, sharks are kind of like scavengers. They want a really easy meal.
Mm-hmm.
And so they don't want to work very hard for it. And if you think about dolphins, you rarely ever see just one dolphin like swimming by itself. And so safety numbers are typically in really large
mm-hmm.
pods. And a shark doesn't want to have to deal with that. They don't want the hassle. So maybe they're a little bit smarter and they're like, I'll just eat the easy stuff.
Maybe. I don't think so.
Okay.
Anyway, so kind of fun. But yeah, so as far as your question, it's a little bit separated there. All right, we're going to move on and talk a little bit about life history and reproduction and how that happens. So hold on.
I did.
Anand, did you participate with the R.G. Dunlap Conservation Project? If so, cool. Talk about that for a second.
I did. I was, you'll actually see me on their website, which is really funny. If you go to sharktagging.com, my little plug, I'm on their website and they do really, really awesome work. I worked very closely with all the people in the organization. They're wonderful, wonderful people. I can't say enough good things about them. So
cool. Nice catch there. All right, so we will jump into life history and reproduction. This is kind of cool because sharks reproduce in a number of ways, right?
Right.
And in general, sharks and rays live a pretty long time.
For sure.
They have, with the longest being, what is it? The dogfish can live up to 75 years old.
Yeah.
And then they also have a very long gestation. So depending on if they lay an egg, give live birth, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, it's not something that happens quickly.
Right. So gestation's kind of a big word. It's talking about how long it takes for the embryo to mature inside the mother and the time from when it's fertilized to actually being born. That's going to be the gestation period. So it can be very, very long for these sharks, you know, longer than hours. It could go up to, I think I read, 15 months.
Yeah,
so.
it's quite a bit. And then also with that, this is kind of a shark conservation issue, but it takes a long time for sharks to mature.
For sure.
They're not going to be born and a year later be laying eggs or giving birth. I mean, it takes a while for
right.
them to get sexually mature. So when we think about, you know, shark finning, which we'll talk about, and killing sharks, it's not a good thing.
No,
so.
Very unsustainable. There's the way in which we're fishing for sharks, we are taking out millions more sharks that are able to be put back into the population, and that's the biggest issue, is that it's just very unsustainable.
And we've talked about that before, too, that if you pull a shark out or you pull an animal out before it's had a chance to, like, give back to the population, I mean, you're stopping the population from growing.
Exactly.
Or even, in some cases, sustaining itself, which is why we say it's not sustainable.
Right.
So we'll kind of get into that later, though. We actually have a whole day on fisheries, and we'll talk more about that. But as far as reproduction, speaking of these long gestations and laying eggs and all that stuff, let's get in and talk a little bit about the differences. So we have egg layers, which I think is important to point out that some sharks and all skates lay eggs.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
But stingrays are not a skate.
Right.
And they give live birth.
Right.
Just want to point that out. Just saying.
So lots of little caveats to that rule. But yeah, the egg is really, really cool. We see them all the time. we see that all the time in the aquarium. Our sharks lay eggs all the time in our touch pools. And so there are these little leather cases, and you know, I'm not so sure about here, but where I'm from on Long Island in New York, we get those mermaids purses mm-hmm. washing up on the beach all the time. So they're really neat to see.
And with this picture, if we can go full screen here, with an egg, when you think of an egg, we think of yolk, right? So here's the baby shark, and right attached to the baby shark, right here, we can see it attached, is the big yolk sac. So this is what's providing all of the nutrients to the shark. And so as the baby over here gets bigger, we're going to notice the shark's yolk, or the baby's yolk sac, getting smaller. So it's like a transition of energy from the yolk to the baby, and that takes time. And that's what we were saying. Sometimes it's many months, up
right.
to 15 months for that baby to get fully developed. So that essentially is what it looks like to have a baby in an egg sac.
Yes. So not like a chicken egg.
Yeah. Wes asked Stacy, what, you can't ask me too, did you ever go cage diving?
I have been cage diving, and it was awesome. You have to do it. Don't tell your mom I said that, but you have to do it. It is the coolest thing I've done, one of the coolest things I've done. Very, very cool. So I was in South Africa. I went off of out of Cape Town.
I've heard it's amazing there.
It was spectacular.
Love it. All right, so that's basically egg-laying sharks. And again, the sharks that are egg-layers, they can't decide, oh, I'm going to be an egg-laying shark and I'm going to be a live birth. Like,
right.
That particular species of shark or group of sharks, they are egg-layers. But then there are also different sharks that give live birth, right?
Oh,
sure. And that's kind of interesting. One of the pictures that we didn't get a chance to look at is the white tip mating. So we will have internal fertilization, right?
Exactly.
If we can pull that up real quick. Sure. We'll go back to it here. So white tip mating. So they'll come together and the males will basically deposit sperm into the female, right?
Exactly.
And the picture right before that is the female and male shark. Let's talk about the differences really quick.
So it's relatively simple to distinguish between the male and female sharks. So our female shark, that's going to be the one on our right side. And you'll notice that it's just those two pelvic fins. There's nothing really else to it. And then in that picture on the left-hand side, you'll notice in between those two pelvic fins are those extra little extensions, and those are called claspers. So our male shark is going to have two claspers. And once you know that they're there, you could go to the aquarium and you could definitely distinguish between males and females.
Yep, pretty easy there. All right, so just bringing that up, I just want to say that internal fertilization, that's important to know sharks. And then let's talk about some of the live birth. Now, one of the most common ways is internal eggs.
Okay.
Right? So we have male and female come together, male deposits the sperm, and then when, like, we think of humans actually get their nutrients directly from their mother.
Right.
And in the case of a lot of sharks, they're just internalized eggs, right? Can
right.
you explain that a little bit more?
So it's something called ovoviviparous.
Right.
And so ovo kind of sounds like egg, right, or an ovum. And then viviparous kind of sounds like vive or life in Spanish. And so you have an egg that also... But you also have live birth. So it's kind of one of those like funky little situations where the baby is coming out live and looking like the adult form, but a smaller version, but it actually came from an egg that had a yolk sac in it within the mother.
So the mom's like internally holding onto the egg, and then the baby is getting the the nutrients from the yolk in the egg
right.
inside the mom.
Right. So unlike us, where we are attached to the uterus and we are getting nutrients directly from the mother, which is also the case in some sharks, they are getting no nutrients from the mother. It's all from that yolk. So really kind of complicated.
Just kind of jumping down, this is kind of a cool thing. The internalized video, or the internalized egg video, we can skip that one, right? We'll just, you wanted to show the cannibalism one?
Yeah.
Okay, so there are some cases where there's intrauterine cannibalism. What is that?
So kind of just sounds exactly how it's said. Or it is exactly what it sounds like, and that is the mother will have several young in her uterus, and the one that's quickest to survive or quickest to mature will actually eat its siblings, and so that will be the way it obtains its nutrients. So really, really cool. And we have an awesome video of it that is borderline creepy, but really, really
cool.
So
real quick, can we very quickly watch the DVD? So it says Cannibals DVD. This is like a little cartoon that will show you what's happening. And then we're going to jump right into the YouTube video of the intrauterine cannibalism. So let's go to those videos because we're getting pretty close on time here. All right. So this would be an example of the intrauterine cannibalism. We've got the one shark that developed the quickest. And it's going to eat all of its brothers and sisters, hence intrauterine in the uterus, cannibalism eating itself. And now we have one big massive shark here that is all full from its brothers and sisters, and there we have it.
Exactly.
All right, so now if we can jump right into the YouTube video of the intrauterine cannibalism, and this one had sound, do you remember?
I don't remember.
Me either, we'll just play it and see. So we can jump into that one and you'll get to see this actually happening inside. It's pretty awesome.
I know. I just wonder where they got the video from.
I know.
I believe there is sound, actually.
The mother continues to produce unfertilized eggs for her mature.
Not so great there, but all right. So they're saying unfertilized eggs here, and it's going to go around and eat the ones that either didn't make it or aren't strong enough. Bye bye. See you, brother. See you, sister. It was fun while it lasted. Nuts.
So already their instinct is just to survive, even though they're not even in the ocean. And they're doing what it takes to survive, and that means eating the other eggs and, unfortunately, their siblings that didn't make it.
That's a lot of nutrients, though. I mean, there's a lot of nutrients in those yolk sacs and... think about us when we eat eggs, there's lots of protein. I mean, that's a good source of protein for us, just like it would be for them. And then the last type of birth is actual true placental live birth, where the baby did get nutrients directly from the mother. So kind of cool. And I believe we have a video for that one as well. This is just going to show us having, I think it's a zebra shark.
And you'll see the umbilical cord. Which is kind of neat.
Perfect. So if we can go to the placental birth video. So again, the baby developed just like we would inside the mom, getting the nutrients from the mother, and then is born. So we'll pull that video up. We were going to
delivering of babies in this shallow, safe lagoon is the closest the mother gets to actually caring for them. She doesn't give them a glance after they're born and surely wouldn't recognize them if she did. In fact, she'd probably try to eat them, although it's thought a shark giving birth is under the influence of a natural appetite suppressant, at least for a while. As soon as they're born, the baby lemons need refuge and head for the shallows and the shelter provided by nearby mangrove roots.
All right, so literally, I mean, you can see that was a huge umbilical cord.
That's really cool.
And that's really interesting. I don't know if you heard what they said, but giving birth is a natural appetite suppressant for at least a little bit. So it gives the babies a little chance to get away, otherwise the moms are going to eat them, right? And then here's a cool picture showing kind of the same thing, the umbilical cord being attached where they get all of their nutrients from. All right, so that pretty much wraps up all these different types of birth. It's kind of interesting to think that these sharks can literally do so many different types. And then one of the last things I want to touch on is conservation, because I think this is huge.
Huge.
And you already mentioned that we're taking out millions more, but there's a main reason that people are doing that, and that's shark finning. So quickly walk me through shark finning.
So finning it actually has a real definition to it, and it's the act of cutting off just the fins of the animal and then throwing the corpse essentially back into the water. So typically the animal's still alive, and you know, obviously we cannot survive with our limbs just cut off and no surgical procedure to cut off our, you know, to seal our blood back in, but they can't swim anymore. So and then they're suffocating, and then it's very easy to just cut off some fins and throw these animals back into the water. And there's a huge market for what we call a shark fin soup, and this is a delicacy, and you know, there's a demand for it. And so as long as there's a demand, we're going to be supplying it, and that's a really big issue.
And they're literally, I mean, millions of sharks every year. And this is just so inhumane. I mean, they're throwing these sharks back that are still alive with no fins to die this slow, miserable death.
Right.
And it just, it's heartbreaking. So luckily, California is really big on, you know, legislation against shark fin soup, against shark fin products, and has banned all of it, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
The other big thing, I think, why sharks aren't protected is because of that stigma we were talking about, that sharks don't eat people. You know,
exactly.
Everyone thinks, oh, they eat people, don't protect them, we don't need them, they're no good for anything. But very, very few shark attacks happen every year. People are more likely to fall and get injured on their toilets, to get killed by a cow.
I think my favorite statistic is more people each year get bit by another person in New York City than they do each year by a shark. And I say, well, I'm from New York. I've never been bit by a person, so I'll take my chances in the ocean.
Yeah, definitely. And then real quick, the other thing we just wanted to point out, and these are just some animals for you to look up, but some of our local species that we have here, if you're into sharks, you liked what we talked about today, we have just a couple that are pretty common. We have leopard sharks, horned sharks, bat rays, and round stingrays.
Right.
So those are ones that you can commonly see, especially if you are a snorkeler in Catalina. We see leopard sharks all the time. Love pointing them out. They're beautiful. One of my favorite sharks. We've seen them in in Blue Cavern before. So really beautiful. Just throwing that out there. But we are just about out of time. So that wraps up our shark day today. So thanks for hanging out and chatting with us, guys. Don't forget, discussion board and quiz are going to be up today, as well as the opportunity for your extra credit question. So you can go on Blackboard and submit that from today's class. Keep working on your research proposal. I will hopefully have your field trip papers graded in the next week or so. There are a lot of you. I will do my best to get those up ASAP. If you have any questions, be in touch. Otherwise, I will see you next week.